Tonight on Intimate Portrait, she had the dream, the drive, the gift. The instant she stepped in front of a microphone, a star was born. A star named Celine Dion.
I'm falling into you. This dream could come true.
I dreamt about this, about having the attention, spotlight, cameras, and being interviewed and talking about my childhood that I'm so proud of, and being in show business, yeah.
For Celine, the dream began when she was just 5, to become a singer. 7 years later, she did, thanks to one man who risked everything to make it possible.
I'm a natural gambler. I like to gamble. I hear this voice that sounds to me like the voice of coming from God, you know? Such a great voice that I played my last chips.
Today, Celine Dion is the star of her very own Happily Ever After story. Adored by millions, she is one of the world's most popular performers. She is living proof of the power of a dream. Celine Dion, tonight, an intimate portrait. Celine Dion has been described in many different ways, from pop's good girl to the next Barbara Streisand.
Tu as guidé mes jeux. Dis-moi ce que tu veux. Je t'aimerai toujours.
But the best way to define Celine is to understand her relationship with her family. She was the last of 14 children born to her parents, Adhemar and Therese Dion. Her mother has been the biggest influence in her life.
I think she's an artist. She has the soul of an artist, my mom. She's a musician. She used to play violin. She's an incredible cook, and she raised 14 kids with so much love and incredible. But she's so smart. She's a very, very smart person.
From the family living room to the family business, the Dion household was filled with music. Almost everyone sang or played an instrument. They owned a piano bar where many of Celine's brothers and sisters worked, taking their turns on stage in between waiting on tables. Mom and Dad also had their own folk music band, and to this day, speak only French. Celine's mother had always dreamed of a career in show business.
Kind of unfortunately for her, she didn't do what she wanted. But if I think of her dreams, she wanted to be as a comedian. She wanted to be on stage. And she's never had the chance to do it. So it's kind of, she gave her life to us.
I was educated in another time, an era where the women stayed at home and took care of the household. I wanted to have a bunch of kids because we were happy in my home. I said, I'd like to have 5. However, sometimes the husband isn't always in agreement because he said, well, me, I don't want any at all.
I didn't want any.
Celine's father worked hard to support his family, sometimes juggling as many as 3 jobs at once. Now, with some of the older children on their own, it was time to slow down. And after 25 years as a full-time housewife and mother, Mrs. Dion was ready to try something different.
And she said to herself, when the kids start school, I'm gonna go and work, and I'm gonna go to meet the world for the first time, and I'm gonna go and have friends. I can't stand to be between four walls of my life anymore. And the day that the kids started school, she found out she was pregnant of me. I think it was a very dramatic situation for my mom at that point. She didn't want that pregnancy.
Mrs. Dion's love of children quickly overcame her reluctance to have another baby. On March 30th, 1968, Celine Dion was born in the tiny French-Canadian town of Charlemagne, Quebec.
Because she came 6 years after the other children, she had many mothers and fathers. Her brothers and sisters were thrilled to have a new baby in the house. They all played mommy and daddy with her.
I was so spoiled. But not spoiled with toys necessarily, but spoiled with really true things and love and affection and attention. Anyway, to make a long story short, it was just, for me, the most beautiful thing to grow up in this family.
Celine's talent for music developed quickly. Her parents realized she was special even before she entered kindergarten.
I think that I noticed it when she was about 5 or 6 years old. I noticed she had a talent. She commanded attention when she spoke or sang.
The first time Celine sang in front of an audience was at her brother Michel's wedding. She was just 5 years old.
I took my microphone. I said, Celine, you can sing now. Go ahead. She said, okay. So she asked my guitar player, okay, give me, you know, I'm going to sing this. So he looked at me and said, which key, Michelle, which key? He said, try someone and anyone. And she just started, said, no, it's not a good one. I mean, you know, 5 years old, can you imagine that? It's not a good one. So he tried another one. So she said, okay, go. And then she was great.
Celine was hooked. It wasn't long before she started asking her father to let her perform at the piano bar.
The little one told me, Dad, I'd love to sing, and I said, you can't sing in the bar. But she kept begging, and finally I said, why not? And when she did sing, my customers all wanted to know who she was. Within 2 weeks, if they knew Celine was going to perform, the bar was full.
Music became an obsession for Celine. Even when she started school, she spent her time daydreaming about being a singer.
I had a hard and bad time at school. You have to try to imagine. When every day of your life there's music, incredible food, smells so good. In the basement of the house, there's your 13 brothers and sisters playing instruments, singing, getting ready for their new show. School, for me, they were taking me away from what I love the most, from my happiness, from the smell of my mom, her clothes, her warmth, the food, the music, the happiness, my family that I love.
By the time she was 11 years old, Celine realized she had the ability to achieve exactly what she wanted, to be a star.
And I was telling my mom every day that I wanted to be a singer. And she said to me that, yeah, but professionally, not in clubs, not just for fun.
She was 11, and I thought, I must do something for her. I will do what it takes to make her a great artist.
Mrs. Dion decided she needed someone to write the perfect song for Celine.
I looked for someone, and they told me, Mrs. Dion, you're dreaming big, because the artists, the composers in Quebec, there are none who write for kids. I told them, thank you very much. I knew she was capable. Therefore, I'll write a song for her.
Celine's brother Jacques wrote the music. Her other brothers and sisters recorded the song on the family tape player at the kitchen table. It was called Ce n'était qu'un rêve. This is the original recording.
dans un grand jardin enchanté.
The English translation, Nothing But a Dream. They sent the tape to René Angélil. René was a successful record producer in Quebec, but had just lost his most important client.
One day I was in my office depressed, and all of a sudden I get this tape with a red ribbon over it, and it's written 12 years old, so I didn't listen to it right away.
So my brother called him, and he said, Mr. Angélil, we know that you didn't listen to the tape because you would have called right away.
I listened to it, and I was amazed. I was shocked at that voice. I called back right away, asked if she could come and sing live in front of me.
And I said, well, I'm used to sing with a microphone, you know? And he said, well, I'll give you my pen. Just imagine, pretend it's a microphone. And he says, when you sing for me, a cappella, no music, nothing. Just pretend you're on stage and you see balconies and you look at the people, you know?
And I was so touched, and at the end, I was crying. And, you know, everything changed since that that day. She had talent, obviously. She was 12 years old with a fantastic voice. And, well, she couldn't speak English at all. So to me, the thing was to make her a star in French, in Quebec, in French Canada. And in France, that was the whole thing. I knew that we could do that.
But no Canadian record companies wanted to take a chance on a 12-year-old kid. René needed to prove to himself and the rest of the world that Céline had a gift.
I hear this voice that comes to me, that sounds to me like the voice of coming from God, you know? Such a great voice that I played my last chips. And in order to play your last chips, you really have to play your last chips. And my last chips was my house.
With no one to finance the dream, René had only one choice. He would have to mortgage his house. This program is sponsored by Reynolds. In 1981, Céline had just been discovered by talent manager René Angélil. Instinctively, René knew she was going to be a superstar. All he had to do was get that first album made.
They all said, let's start with a single. We'll see how it goes. And of course, it's the sensible thing to do. But I really wanted to go all the way and prove that she was something special. And when nobody wanted to invest that kind of money, I had to mortgage my house, which I did, and we proved that she was something special.
Céline was an instant hit, first in Quebec and then in France. The album sold over 1 million copies. Between 1982 and 1989, she recorded 7 albums, appeared on dozens of television shows, and won 15 Felix Awards, the Canadian equivalent of the Grammy. A little girl's dream was coming true. In 1982, Céline dropped out of school to pursue music full-time. That year, she won the Yamaha Song Contest in Tokyo. 1985 was the year she sang for the Pope, and in 1988, she won the Eurovision Song Contest in Dublin. All this without speaking a word of English. Céline was 18 and the most successful Canadian singer in history. But one thing was missing: success in the United States. The language barrier was the problem. So Renee had a plan. Have Céline take a year off.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Okay.
Change her image and learn to speak English.
Hi, how are you?
The corresponding.
The corresponding.
The corresponding.
That's right.
In 2 months, she was fully bilingual. She was ready to try and conquer the American market. Renee assembled some of the best record producers in the business, including David Foster.
She has the money notes. That's how I describe Céline. The money notes are the ability to hit the note dead on and then break into a vibrato and hang there. It's like a bird in the air, you know, like with the wind. Not to get too descriptive, but hey, I'm writing a song here. Wind beneath my wings, that would be a good idea for a song. But it's like a bird just hanging there, you know? She can hit those money notes dead on and then hang there. Her hang time is unbelievable. Can the wings still be left?
The international sensation no one in the United States had heard of returned with her first English language album, Unison. The ruffles and bows gave way to leather and lace. Where Does My Heart Beat Now reached number 5 on the charts. Céline was doing up to 5 shows a week to promote the album. One night, the pace took the ultimate toll. It was every singer's worst nightmare at a concert in Sherbrooke, Quebec. When Céline tried to sing, she couldn't make a sound. Her voice was completely gone.
When I lost my voice, it was like losing everything. There's a lot of things you have to go through in life. It makes you stronger. And I lost my voice once, it's true. I went on stage, sang the first song, gave it all I got. I had nothing, but I don't know how I did it. Second song, guitar solo, I went out backstage and I started to cry.
The initial diagnosis, there were nodes on her vocal cords. The solution, surgery. But the operation would likely ruin her voice. Céline wanted a second opinion, so she traveled to New York City and met with throat specialist Dr. Wilbur Gould and Dr. Gwen Corovan. They didn't find any nodes, but Céline's vocal cords were severely inflamed. Dr. Gould prescribed a radical course of therapy.
He saved my life, and he said to me, if you want to sing all your life, you have to stop talking right now for 3 weeks. No whispering. I'm going to teach you how to sneeze again, how to cough and how to laugh. But he said, no talking, no whispering for 3 weeks. I didn't went like, what? It was not difficult for me. Somebody wanted to give my life back. I was willing to do anything.
She showed how much discipline she had and how much she wanted to succeed by sometimes going 48 hours without talking. She still does that.
Now, Céline treats her vocal cords like athletes treat their bodies. She keeps her voice limber with a precise 45-minute daily routine of vocal exercises.
It's weird. You know, you do like a... What's that? You know, am I going to do this on stage tonight? Mm-mm. Or... Everything has to vibrate from the right place. Or like a... Sometimes I do my vocal exercise in my room at the hotel. The person in the room next to this, like, is like, what is she doing, this girl? You know, it sounds quite weird. But anyway, I have to do what I have to do.
It's half of a teaspoon of baking soda and half of a teaspoon of salt in warm water. Just gargle and throw it away.
voice got stronger and her English got better. But some of the subtleties of the language still escaped her.
She sang something incredible. Duh, what a surprise. And I said, man, that was bitchin'. And she truly thought I'd called her a bitch. And she, Renee, and then started babbling away in French and wasn't quite sure what was happening. But again, all good-naturedly. And, you know, she just doesn't seem to know how to have a bad day.
Record executives in the United States began to notice Celine. Polly Anthony is the president of Sony 550 Music, Celine's record company. She first heard Celine's voice in 1989.
I remember being called into my boss's office. He said, I want you to listen to something and tell me what you think. And this was a song from Unison he was playing. And literally, probably three bars in, I was just captivated by this magnificent voice. And I just looked at him and said, we have to have her. We have to have her. And we got her.
Unison sold 1.7 million records. That led to her next big break. In 1992, on her self-titled Celine Dion album, she sang Beauty and the Beast, a duet with Peebo Bryson.
Certain night the sun,
certain night the sun,
rising in the east,
till our song is
done, song as old as
Celine won a Grammy and the song captured an Oscar in 1993. The album has sold 3.4 million copies. In the 12 years since she started, 1993 was the best yet. It was a year of professional triumphs, but it was also to be a year filled with personal tragedy. Celine's niece, Corinne, would lose a 16-year battle with cystic fibrosis. I'm Joan London. Celine Dion, An Intimate Portrait, continues. As Celine's career headed into the stratosphere, a family crisis pulled her back to earth. Celine's niece Corinne had been battling cystic fibrosis since birth. In the spring of 1996, the illness forced her into the hospital. Celine and Renee rushed to her side. Corinne had one request, a nice pair of pajamas. While Celine stayed by her side, Renee disappeared.
We start to talk, and Renee arrives with a package, and Celine asked him, where have you been? And he said Corinne had told me earlier that she wanted some pajamas. He had gone to a store, made them open up, and then bought two pairs of pajamas. He said, I know she has sent me a message. She wanted to be beautiful at the moment of her death.
Before Renee could make it back to the hospital, Corinne had died.
She passed away in my arms, actually. And I was singing to her in her ears, very, very soft. And I felt every single part of her body leaving us. It was very, very hard, but at the same time, I think it was an incredible gift. In French, we say accompagner quelqu'un to heaven, to be there with them.
After Corinne's death, Celine's friend, songwriter Jean-Jacques Goldman, wrote Fly.
Fly, fly, do not fear. Don't waste the breath, don't shed a tear. Your heart is pure, your soul is free. Beyond. Wait for me.
And he captured this feeling. I don't know how, but Jean-Jacques Goldman has written what I felt for Karine.
Above the universe you'll climb, on beyond the hands of time. The moon will rise, the sun will set.
Karine will always be part of my life, and I'm very proud that she has a song for her.
By the time of Corinne's death, the relationship between Renee and Celine had evolved beyond manager and artist. The 12-year-old girl was now a 25-year-old woman.
Every day of my life, I got to know him a little better and better and better. And with the years, I fell in love with him, with everything he did, everything he didn't do, and everything we want to do together and we're looking forward to.
Renee's marriage had ended. After taking care of Celine all those years, she was now his shoulder to lean on.
At one point, we got really close. I knew I loved him, and I think I kind of felt he loved me, but, I mean, how much and how serious? And anyway, 20 years old, a kiss goodnight was different suddenly.
I can't explain it. It's just that when we left each other every night, it was harder. And one night in Dublin, actually, I think she felt the same way. Well, I know she felt the same way.
The man who had made every business decision and organized every aspect of Celine's life now made the ultimate decision. Renee asked Celine to marry him.
And I remember we came in at night after a show. And he said, you know, we should put our bathrobes tonight. I'm gonna order room service. So that night he says, only the two of us. Okay, no problem with me. I love that.
But now, the man who always knew exactly what to do was floundering.
I was very, very nervous and you know, I tried to create a mood in the room. It was in a hotel room.
I see him. He's trying so hard to find the perfect lighting. He goes in the bathroom, he opens the light, he closes the door, little too dark, opens the door, goes in the living room, opens it. He's trying so hard. And I don't say anything because I see him coming like he wants to have a romantic night. Okay, no problem. I'm always ready for that.
She had just come from New York from a voice lesson, and I had a ring, and I was clumsy like crazy. First of all, I took out the box, and, you know, instead, I started crying.
He opens the box towards him. He doesn't show me anything. He opens the box. He starts to cry, and he says, you know, I've never done such a thing before. I've never done this before. I've never proposed before. And I looked at him, said, what? I started to laugh with tears in my eyes, but I was laughing.
Finally, she understood what I wanted to do, and she said yes.
I'll paint my moon in shades of blue. Paint my soul to be with you.
Renee's plan for matrimony was now squarely in the way of his master plan for Celine's career. Because she was now an international superstar, they lived their lives under the media microscope. Their 27-year age difference was perfect fodder for the tabloids. So they kept their relationship a secret.
It was at the beginning of my career in English. And I didn't want people to think, oh, she goes out with her manager, and he's much older than her, and oh my God, she's just a child, and it's just like a sugar daddy type of thing, romance. I knew what I was feeling, and what I was feeling was right. I couldn't bear the fact that I could not walk hand in hand on the street. When I was coming to America, I couldn't kiss him. I wanted to scream to the whole world, I'm in love, and I'm gonna write my feeling to him, for him, the way I feel. If people want it, they read it. If they're not agree with it, I'm not asking them their permission, but I wanted people to know.
The announcement was simple. On the cover of the Color of My Love album, Celine wrote four sentences.
Renee, for so many years, I've kept our special dream locked away inside my heart. But now it's getting too powerful to keep this inside of me. So after all these years, let me paint the truth, show how I feel, try to make you completely real. Renee, you're the color of my love. Celine.
To warm your heart,
Their private love affair became very public on December 17, 1994. In front of 500 friends and family, Celine and René were married at the Notre Dame Cathedral in Montreal. It became Canada's royal wedding. The $500,000 gala was televised live across the country.
Longue, heureuse vie, pleine de bonheur.
Merci.
It was the end of a perfect year. The Color of My Love had sold more than 13 million albums. But her biggest success was yet to come. Her Falling Into You album would make her one of the best-selling artists of 1996.
Devoted love until we die.
Return to Celine Dion, An Intimate Portrait. Celine and René's wedding offered only a brief respite from the hectic pace of her career. Within weeks, she was back on tour.
We're going to Cleveland, right?
Right.
See ya.
For the Falling Into You tour in 1996, Celine performed over 100 concerts and traveled thousands of miles to dozens of different cities. Even though life on the road may look glamorous, for a singer, it becomes a necessary evil. It's a grind, nonstop travel to as many as 4 different cities in a week. Many performers hate it, but Celine Dion embraces it.
I do all this because of one thing, because I want to go on stage, because it's a two-ways thing. When you're in studio and you sing, you put those headphones in your head, on your head, and you sing a song, there's no feedback. You have to become an actress and feel your song, and there's no feedback. The engineer doesn't even look at you when you sing. But on stage, you say, for all those crazy, they sing with you, something, oh my god, they take a picture, they go like this, and it's like, it gets very emotional.
I'm everything I am, because you are me.
The personal touch is important to Celine. After every concert, she spends time with small groups of fans backstage. She does as many of these meet and greets as possible.
Don't forget a smile.
You want?
I think that it is magical and rare when you can get an artist to connect with the people. And she has an ability to do that. She really cares. Celine cares about human beings. She makes that connection.
I wish you the very best, and hopefully we can do some gospel thing one day. Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah.
Celine. 1996 was the year it all came together for Celine. the ultimate concert date was in Atlanta at the opening ceremony of the Summer Olympics.
It has to be the biggest moment of my career, the peak. And a lot of people say, yeah, but what about the 4 billion people almost watching it? And to be honest with you, I was concerned. I mean, I was a little bit thinking about it in the previous days, but I was not thinking too much about the 4 billion people watching, because you don't get to see the 4 billion people. And I didn't want to be too scared.
After 16 years on the road, Celine Dion had realized her dream.
It just doesn't happen overnight or by luck or because she has a hit song. This is an artist who works day and night to get this done.
To this day, she will stand in front of the microphone for 8 hours and literally raise her hand if she wants to go to the bathroom. Now, I can't find, my kids won't do that. Nobody will do it. A singer that's like, doesn't even have a record deal won't do that. Like after 4 hours, they'll be kind of like, okay, are we done now? And they're looking for a record deal.
And in your eyes, I see rhythms of color.
The Falling Into You album sold over 22 million copies and was nominated for 7 Grammys, including Best Female Performer and Album of the Year.
I'm falling into you. This dream could come true.
Everyone thought she would win for Best Female Performer. Everyone was wrong.
When she didn't win that, well, I figured that there was something wrong with the vote.
I felt as though one of my sisters had been dissed, you know, and so I found myself just not acting particularly professional, but just sort of griping under my breath and like running up to see she and Renee in between and saying, you know.
So when she didn't win that, I was thinking, no way she's gonna be winning Best Album.
And the Album of the Year is Falling Into You, Celine Dion.
I don't do show business to win awards. When you do something, you give the best of yourself. You know if you're good or not. You know if you can do better or not. That's the only thing to me that counts.
First of all, I would like to thank my parents and my 13 brothers and sisters for giving me the love of music.
4 a.m., another concert completed. Another plane ride and another show just ahead. The demands of a successful career, the tours, the albums, the fans, consume most of Celine's energy. But she doesn't complain. Celine understands what it takes to be a superstar.
You can't have everything. You cannot be in show business, sell, I don't know, let's talk about numbers for 1 second, 21 million records, have sold out shows, tour the world, make money, buy a house to your parents, have beautiful Christmas presents for your family you love, have a fairy tale wedding. You cannot have all this and ask the people, leave me alone. Don't look at me eating. Don't take a picture of me, because when you go to a restaurant, your mouth is full of food and they make sure they take a picture when your mouth is open. This is okay. People seeing that with normal human beings. People will ask you your autographs, your pictures, and you'll have pimples all over your face one day. You'll have stomach pain and headaches and say, oh, nice to meet you. I'm so not feeling so good today. Come here. Okay. Thank you. You have to deal with, I'm a public person. I grew up with 13 brothers and sisters. I'm used to have people surrounding me all the time. If I cannot deal with it, I stay home. Right now, I'm happy with it.
Return to Celine Dion, An Intimate Portrait. Most of the year, Celine's life is a non-stop flurry of high-energy activity. But when she's not touring, Celine thrives on the solitude and comfort of just being home.
I like quiet very much. Never I will open the television. Never I will hear the radio. All the music I need my body to express, I do it all year long. When I'm home, I did what I need to do, and that's it. I think you love doing things that you don't get the chance to do very much. I love being home. I'm never home. Never. Rarely home. I love to cook and clean my house because I don't have to do it every day. I'm sure it's that. And I love to drive my car because I'm always having drivers driving me.
Even during the quiet times, Celine's life is full of business associates, friends, and family.
I'm never really alone. And I don't think I want that. I mean, of course, I have my time if I'm really tired and I need to... I'll jump in the pool and under the water, I'll be by myself for sure. But I'm so used to be surrounded with people that to me, it's kind of a support. It's kind of security for me.
Celine and Renee have been very open about wanting to start a family.
I think why it doesn't happen maybe now, because there's too many things going on right now. In my heart, in my soul, in my voice, in my head, in my dreams, there's too many things, it's too much pressure. When I'm gonna have days off, and I mean, not days off, but a break, a long break, I think I'm gonna get pregnant. If yes, yes, if no, no. I mean, I'm not waiting for that to be happy. I'm the happiest person in the world, but it will be complete for us.
To those around her, Celine really hasn't changed that much from the 12-year-old who pretended the pen was a microphone.
You know, when I see her perform today, and I love to go in the audience and watch the show, but part of me still sees her like the 12-year-old when she came into that office, and how beautiful a person she stayed in those 15 years, because it's so easy to change in this business. And believe me, she didn't change.
Celine Dion's journey from the obscurity of small-town life to the spotlight of international superstardom proves that dreams that are nurtured and encouraged have a power that is undeniable.
There was lots of dreams where I grew up. I never heard in the house that dreams are like, oh yeah, but you know, it's not possible. We always kept faith. We always talked about dreams. And yes, I dreamt about this, about having the attention, spotlight cameras, and being interviewed and talking about my childhood that I'm so proud of, and being in show business, yeah.
Intimate Portrait, I'm Joan London.
Wait till you see who's...